Karen Grisey on my far left is a member of the litigation department and a resident in the D.C. office of our host, which is the law firm of Reed Frank. So thank you, Karen, again for hosting us today. Karen joined the firm in 1990 and became its public service counsel in 1996. And in that role, she manages the intake and placement of pro bono matters, acts as liaison to national and local bar associations and legal service providers, and provides substantive advice and assistance to countless pro bono attorneys. Her expertise is broad. It spans political asylum, immigration, veterans benefits, family law, landlord-tenant issues, and general civil litigation. She's a nationally recognized litigator and policy expert on immigration issues, and she's past chair of the ABA Commission on Immigration, and she serves on numerous boards of directors, including the board of directors of my agency, the Center for Migration Studies. Bo Cooper, next to Karen, is a partner at Fragaman Worldwide, where he heads the firm's Government Strategies and Compliance Group. He served as general counsel of the Immigration and Naturalization Service between 1999 and early 2003. He's a well-recognized expert. He testifies frequently before Congress and makes regular television, radio, and print media appearances. He also handles an extensive pro bono practice addressing asylum, convention against torture, and a wide range of other cases. And Julie Myers Wood, to my immediate left, is the Chief Executive Officer of Guidepost Solutions, LLC, and the former director of DHS's Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency. Guidepost Solutions is a leading investigative and compliance consulting firm. Prior to Julie's leadership at ICE, Ms. Wood served as the Assistant Secretary for Export Enforcement at the Department of Commerce, Chief of Staff for the Criminal Division at the Department of Justice, and Deputy Assistant Secretary at the Treasury Department. She's also a nationally recognized expert and speaker on immigration and other law enforcement issues. She regularly testifies before Congress and appears before numerous media outlets. And she was also, I should say, a valued member of the ABA Commission on Immigration. That's kind of a common theme of some of us up here. So thanks to all of you for joining us today. We really are grateful to you. And so what we've decided to do is to lead with a legal overview of the issues raised in the case by Karen Grisey, and then we'll go through the issues before the court in order and allow our panelists to speak to them. So Karen, if you could start, we'd appreciate it. And I think we're going to leave questions until the end of the panel discussion, but we'll have time for that. Okay.
Sure. Thank you, Don. Good morning and welcome, everyone. I thought what I would do is, for the benefit of the people in the room who are not 100% immersed in this issue and their, you know, life focused on what's going to happen on Monday morning, I'd give a little bit of a background on what the progress was of the case through the lower courts, and especially focus on the couple of places where there are some differences in what happened below and what's coming before the court now, and then to frame up a bit the distinction between the technical legal issues that the court is going to confront necessarily and the actual substance of the program. So the people coming after me will be able to talk about the legal issues, but also what we care about. How does it impact the program? What actually may or may not happen, and so forth. So the first thing is to say, who are the plaintiffs? It's at my count, 26, I think, states, Texas being the principal one, the first state and the only state who actually so far has been found definitely to have standing below, but there are 26 total, and as the brief for the states emphasized, that's more than half of the states. So it's not, you know, you can't say it's outliers or whatever that are coming in and challenging the program. So Texas and the 25 other states started off in the U.S. District Court in Texas seeking a preliminary injunction to block the implementation of the expanded DACA and DAPA program that we talked about. that is where the issue of the take care clause of the Constitution was first raised. We'll take that, talk more about that in a moment. But they did argue that the guidance, that is the substantive program that we're talking about, violates the take care clause, that it was arbitrary and capricious in its design, and that only could have been properly adopted following notice and comment rulemaking under the APA. And the biggest injury that Texas complained about was that it would have to give driver's licenses to the recipients of the DAPA or expanded DACA, and that would be at cost to them, because their policy is to give driver's licenses to persons who are lawfully present or present with permission in the United States, so that this great big expansion of the category of persons who could potentially receive benefit under the program would then have an attendant cost to them on accommodating the driver's licenses at a minimum. So the district court did issue a nationwide preliminary injunction, even though the case was only filed in Texas. They issued the injunction nationwide, which meant that it was not only restricted to Texas, but across the country there could be no movement forward toward implementation of the program. The district court did find that the plaintiff states were likely to succeed on standing, on having a justiciable cause of action on the APA claim, and that notice and comment rulemaking was required. The district court did not reach the substantive APA claim, the arbitrary and capricious claim that we'll talk about, or the constitutional claim, the take care clause claim. So the district court didn't get that far. The United States then appealed to the Fifth Circuit, the Court of Appeals with jurisdiction over Texas, and they sought a stay of the preliminary injunction and expedited processing of the case on the merits. They won on the expedited processing because of the importance of the claim and the understanding that regardless of the outcome, the case was likely to be moving forward for higher review. But the stay of the preliminary injunction got denied 2-1, and ultimately the preliminary injunction was also upheld 2-1 by the appeals court, although the panels were different and the dissenting judge was different in the those two decisions. So the Fifth Circuit did find that Texas, at least because of the driver license issue that I articulated, had Article III standing, had a justiciable claim under the ABA, and was likely to be able to show that notice and comment rulemaking was required. And then, on a point not found by the district court, found that the guidance, that the actual expanded DACA and DAPA program was, quote, manifestly contrary to the INA. So that concept worked itself in at the Fifth Circuit level. The dissents, obviously not controlling, their view and their reasons for dissenting was that the guidance fell within a subject matter area that was within the non-reviewable discretion of the administrative agency, but that was not the prevailing view. So the United States then went forward and sought certiorari, arguing against the nationwide injunction, emphasizing the importance of the federal immigration policy and the intrusion into the formerly well-established limits of judicial power. And the government argued that this injunction allowed the states to frustrate federal enforcement of immigration law by letting one state with basically a self-created problem or self-created hardship thwart a federal immigration program. So that was the basis. There were three arguments, and I'll go through them, but that was basically the gist of the United States petition to the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court granted cert on the three issues that were raised by the United States, and I'm going to give them to you, but then it added a direction for a briefing on a fourth. The three that were in the cert petition and are going forward are whether a state that voluntarily provides a subsidy, that's the driver's license issue,
voluntarily provides a subsidy to all aliens with deferred action, has Article III standing and a justiciable cause of action under the APA to challenge the guidance because it will lead to more aliens having deferred action. Okay. Number two, whether the guidance is arbitrary and capricious or otherwise not in accordance with law. And the third one is whether the guidance was subject to the APA's notice and comment procedures. So those issues are well developed in the record and more so before the Supreme Court. Then the court went back and picked up this one prior issue that was originally raised to the district court and very briefly addressed in the opposition to the cert petition and directed the parties to brief and argue the fourth question, which is whether the guidance, the expanded DACA and DAPA program, violates the Take Care Clause of the Constitution from Article 2, Section 3. So those are the four questions, and there was authorized, actually by Justice Scalia before he passed away, expanded word count, you know, larger briefs were permitted, and expanded time for oral argument. I'm sure partly because of the seriousness of the issues, but also because four to brief and argue is, you know, quite a bit to manage in the traditional period. So I'm going to go through very briefly just what the issues are about. The Article III standing justiciable controversy one, that requires that the plaintiff show an individual injury to a legally protected interest that's fairly traceable to the defendant's conduct and redressable by a favorable decision. So here, the articulated individualized injury that it's been found below that at least Texas had was the need to provide subsidized driver's licenses, or expanding that idea a little bit, substantial pressure to change its own law in order to not give driver's licenses. So one way or the other, this is the state's argument that's basically been accepted below, one way or the other, the states have to do something, right? They either have to change their own law or they have to bear the cost of implementing or coping with the program. So that's the injury, and the question is whether that's a cognizable injury traceable to the policy, because the policy on its face doesn't require Texas to do anything, but you can see where in implementation, in a sense, it does. The government also says that states are just like private people who can't challenge immigration enforcement decisions because that's a purely federal function under the Constitution, and in fact that states are even less likely or less able to challenge them because of the federal-state dichotomy in the enforcement scheme. With immigration enforcement committed specifically to the federal government, states are the last ones who should be able to come in and have standing to do anything. On the question of legally protected interest, the traditional concept is that to bring a lawsuit, somebody has to be within the zone of interest contemplated by the statute, within the meaning of the statute. And so part of the argument is whether states can fit within the zone of interest under this particular program. There's also an exception from the APA judicial review provisions, which are executive actions that are totally committed to agency discretion are not reviewable. And so the argument is, as I mentioned before, that this puts the courts deep into the area of federal-state disputes and gets into review of what are actually political questions. Interestingly, the Fifth Circuit found that the decision to forbear from deportations in the program is not reviewable, but that the deferred action part, the part about conferring a benefit, letting people get work permits, letting people potentially receive Social Security and other benefits that flow from the deferred action, that's the part that isn't within agency discretion. And so that's where the biggest part of that challenge is. Whether the second question, whether the action was arbitrary and capricious or not in accordance with law, that's the one that gets closest to the policy decision, whether there was a good basis for the program, whether it was well-reasoned and so forth. it's undisputed that the government has unreviewable discretion to decide whether to put somebody in removal proceedings or to execute an enforcement order. There's a long history by both political parties, administrations on both sides, about using deferred action. But the question here is really where, not the deferred action itself again, but whether they can go further to create a perceived benefit, particularly with work permits, but the others that I mentioned. And the government argues that the the continued authorization to remain and to have a work permit is basically at odds with the statutory ability to become a permanent resident or to get cancellation of removal, that part of the program is really at odds with the statute, and that's why there is in part an abuse of discretion. The notice and comment issue is really that turns on whether this program amounts to a substantive rule or not. Generally, statements of policy are not substantive rules, and statements of policy, how the government is going to exercise its authority, don't require notice and comment rulemaking, but the states say this is not that. This goes beyond a statement of policy. It is a substantive rule, and policy statements can't be binding, and here the program sets the criteria sufficiently stringently that the adjudicating officers have no discretion to decide whether to grant the remedy or not. So in that sense, it's binding, no longer discretionary. That makes it not policy. That makes it require APA rulemaking. The last one, the take care clause, has not been applied by a court before, as far as I know, to give jurisdiction for federal court review. It's been more seen as a path to impeachment or something if the president didn't faithfully execute the laws. But it is being raised here. The court has asked for briefing on it, so I'm interested to hear what other people think about why and how they may address that. But when I look at it, it looks like the question of faithful execution really folds back on the arbitrary and capricious part of the argument, and whether what the president and the administration has done can be upheld as a faithful exercise of the laws and the authority that's committed to the executive branch. So those, I think those are the four basic questions, and then we'll let people talk about those in more detail, and especially what the arguments are from sort of different perspectives.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Karen. That was an excellent summary. Appreciate it. So why don't we jump in? I think that the first set of issues are the don't seem like very glamorous issues. You know, my apologies to the law professors who may be listening to this, because they're the standing issues. But the fact is that they're decisive, or maybe decisive at the very least, to the decision here. And let me just kind of, what we're going to do is we're going to go through each of these four issues that Karen laid out in order. Each panelist doesn't have to respond to each issue. I know that both is not extremely interested in responding to the standing issue, for example, but you're welcome to jump in on any of these. But just to kind of tee up this one again, the issue is whether a state that voluntarily provides a subsidy to all aliens who have deferred action has Article III standing and a justiciable cause of action under the Administrative Procedure Act, or the APA, to challenge the president's guidance. So do states have standing under Article III of the APA to bring these cases? Under Article III, as we know, courts can take up cases only if there's a case of controversy, that is an actual dispute between real parties. Central to the case and controversy limitation on the judicial power is the requirement of an injury. So the main question is, do states have standing based on the injury and cost to them, which would have been caused by the federal action? Dellinger, who's not here, would have argued that there's no case of controversy that causes any injury here. If Texas is injured, it's only because it failed to change its subsidized driver's license fee schedule. And of course, the states disagree very vigorously with that position. But let me turn to In any particular order that you'd like to go?
I actually have a couple of thoughts to start,
okay,
off,
yeah.
To start off the standing discussion. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a delight to join you. I appreciate the panel and appreciate everyone's time this morning. I mean, many of you might be steeped in the jurisprudence of standing. For those of you who aren't, just to restate in the simplest terms the question that that Don and Karen articulated so well. The standing requirement's there to make sure that if you want to invoke the authority of a court, that you've been hurt by what the person you're suing did. That's the basic question. In this instance, that is, as John and Karen pointed out, potentially a dispositive issue here. If you look at the briefs that the party submitted, probably of the 50 pounds of briefing, 20 pounds of them are on standing and complex issues of grants patriae theories of standing and whether states have deserved special solicitude and what you can calculate as harm. But what the court's decision boiled down to when it found that Texas and the states do have standing, and there were a lot of potential harms asserted. What the court wound up focusing on, of course, was this driver's license. Texas said, we subsidize driver's licenses for those who are eligible. If you, the federal government, does something to make more people eligible, then you can, you know, you can do a straight mathematical equation and figure out the dollar number of extra costs we're going to incur to subsidize driver's licenses. And you know, extra dollars is harm. And that was the basic basis of the court's decision that Texas and the states had standing to bring this claim. I don't have deep expertise in the general jurisprudence of standing, but I do want to express just a couple of thoughts on what that will mean in the immigration context, if that is found to be a basis for standing. It's hard to imagine any federal immigration policy that's not going to have some consequence in the states. The states are where the affected people live, and if this articulated basis of standing is sufficient to allow a state to bring a suit in federal court against a federal immigration policy, it's difficult for me to envision where the limit of that is, what kind of federal policy there is that doesn't have some kind of consequence that on the states, like that on the states. And you know, you could imagine, for example, any shift in border enforcement priorities is going to be a shift away from other border enforcement priorities. And I would imagine the different states that articulate a disproportionate effect on activities within their boundaries by that. Anytime there is a regulatory decision to authorize additional employment for categories of aliens, as DHS has just done in a couple of business-related instances, when you can just run through from enforcement to benefits, it's difficult for me to conceive what federal immigration policy is not going to have some articulable consequence involving costs included on the states. Julie's got deep expertise in immigration administration from the executive branch side. I'd be curious from your perspective as well. But it's sobering to think of the range of state brought lawsuits that are possible against federal immigration policies. A wide range of federal immigration policies, if standing is upheld here. And you know, let's remember also that in this instance, the preponderance of the states, the ones who have brought the lawsuit, they oppose the policy. They're challenging it. There are states that support the policy. And so when you're looking at this potential terrain of state lawsuits or a combination of states' lawsuits against federal immigration policy, you know, you've got to consider the potential for not just claims brought by people who like what you're doing, but who don't like what you're doing, but you know, counterclaims by those who like what you're doing and so forth. It just seems to me to be to raise the prospect of a very complex litigation terrain standards.
You have to turn off one of the.
Come Great, I want to also extend my thanks for the invitation. And you might have noticed I was a few minutes late here this morning. I was also kind of late to the party in analyzing kind of these briefs and thinking about what would happen. If you look at how many briefs have been filed on both sides, you're not on one of the briefs, are you? You are, yes. I think I'm the only person not on one of the briefs that's kind of in the immigration community of a former commissioner or a former Homeland Security official. It seems like everyone who had their finger in some point had to get their name on the brief. And I actually, on a brief. And I was actually asked several times to join a brief, but I didn't really want to. And the reason is, I think that this case raises some very tough choices. You know, what do we do with the, what are the executive branch options in a very messed up system, right? And how can we resolve things? If Congress refuses to act, what can we then do? And is Congress's refusal enough to cause the executive to stand back? And so for that reason, I had not looked at these briefs, and this is only a very small piece of the briefs here, and in very much detail until actually preparing for this. But I did, I'm not a constitutional scholar. I did do very well in federal courts and not so well in administrative law. So you may see those discrepancies in my analysis. And I just want to say from the bottom line perspective, I think what the president wanted to do is the kind of thing we have to have happen in our messed up system. But then turning back, we're not the policy panel, so turning back to the legal argument, does Texas have standing? And I actually think yes, because Texas does have standing. And I think it's pretty clear under a particular case, Massachusetts versus EPA, a 2007 Supreme Court decision where they said states are different. States have special solicitude. They are not normal litigants. And when you look at injury, you have to treat the states differently. And I think that how the Supreme Court looks at this Massachusetts versus EPA case is going to be very important in terms of whether or not they determine that Texas and the other states have standing kind of in this instance. If they're not normal litigants, then we're looking at the injury. What is the injury that Texas had? Texas had, I think very importantly, a pre-existing law. They had a pre-existing law. It was on the books at least 1 year before the first DACA and DAPA came out. And that said, that you, if you have lawful presence, we're going to be able to give you a driver's license. And I think that piece is important. Texas didn't change its law after the administration came out with these policies. It's important they had this pre-existing law on the books. Whether or not they had thought about the administration was going to do something, I don't know. But I think it's important they had a pre-existing law on the books. And then for their driver's license, they subsidized their driver's license. And that was their policy. And so it's hard to believe we're fighting over $75 a driver's license or something. Not a huge amount of money. And they are subsidizing it. And then after the change, it's not the prioritization, it's the lawful presence. Individuals under DAPA would be eligible to get these driver's licenses, and Texas would be forced to pay. And that's where they could show millions of dollars that they are forced to spend because of the change in law. And so there are several things that are response to that. First, you could say, well, shouldn't Texas, you just change their law? You change your law. If you don't like it, stop subsidizing it. But actually, in Massachusetts versus EPA, and then also a later case, Arizona State Legislature versus Arizona redistricting, the Supreme Court has said, if the state is pressured to change something, that is not that also can be quite a part of the injury. So the state can't be forced to change the law. And so here we have, for $24, this is an injury. It's a legitimate injury. And if states are special litigants, if they're special litigants, then I think they in fact do have standing. And we'll have to get kind of to at some point to kind of to these other issues. It is interesting because in Massachusetts versus EPA, there Massachusetts was challenging the EPA's failure to act. And of course, as some of you who know standing may know, it's even harder to get standing for a failure to act versus an action. And there the court found that it did, that Massachusetts did have standing. And so I think they're going to have to look at their whole standing jurisprudence and decide, how do we want to treat states? I take Bo's point very well. What will this mean in immigration? But frankly, you could say that across the board. What will this mean? Every person in a state is affected by clean air or not clean air. And so if we're going to allow states to challenge these things, I think it could have very broad effect. Now, whether or not states would try to challenge the border enforcement priorities, they've sued before on certain things. So I think that would be interesting. How did they show the identifiable injury there? But if states are allowed to do this, and I think under current jurisprudence they will be, this could open the door up, I think, quite far.
That's the thing that actually bothers me a bit. When I understand and take Bo's point about, you know, the big problems that develop if every single state is allowed to challenge, you know, not only anything in immigration, but anything that's committed to federal jurisdiction, basically. Then I go back and think about when I went to the oral argument in the Arizona case, I found myself sympathetic, which is something that didn't usually happen with Justice Scalia, when he asked the point about, you know, why Arizona, if this is an obligation of the entire United States, right, why is it that Arizona, by virtue of where it sits in the border region, should basically get stuck with all the costs of healthcare, education, trash, whatever other thing happened? Because the United States makes the enforcement decisions and they are kind of stuck with the consequences. So it was a thing where I felt totally opposed to the Arizona legislation, but I took the point that why shouldn't Arizona be allowed to complain? And I understood the standing decision there. The difference, the place where I have problems with it, especially in looking at this Texas issue, is even if they have standing and even if they can challenge it in Texas as to their own injury, how can you have a system where one state can come in because of a pre-existing legislation or whatever and upend an entire scheme for the entire country, even for those states where the governors may be supportive, actually?
And Karen, I think that's an excellent point. You know, making kind of such a broad sweep to go immediately to kind of the nationwide jurisdiction. I think actually the lower court, the district court, made a lot of broad sweeps on his findings of fact. Same sort of thing. All of a sudden, you know, went to, finding that discretion was a pretext or other things. So really drew very broad strokes. And I think that is something that's troubling. You can think about kind of interstate commerce or interstate movement and how could you just affect one location. And certainly here 26 states were involved. But I was frankly surprised to see the injunction drawn so broadly without, I think, the kind of support that you would expect to see.
One quick reaction. I don't want to minimize for a moment the costs, the effects on state budgets of federal immigration policies. No question that that federal immigration policies, including enforcement policies across the board, have effects on state budgets, and some states are in better positions to absorb those costs than others. That's a very, very real issue, and it's one that that I think we've seen in when we were in the administration in trying to manage relationships with the states as effectively as possible and in trying to find that right balance. So I don't want to minimize at all or ignore at all the point that you're making. There certainly are state consequences, state-level consequences, budgetary and otherwise, on immigration, both illegal and illegal, and on immigration and for immigration policy. But just to return to the point, and I think that there are, you know, it is correct that Arizona is a border state. It is correct that Arizona is that the southwest border states are going to deal with border enforcement problems in ways that other states don't have to. But you can go around the country and find ways that different states are affected in different ways. And again, I find it just hard to figure out where you're going to draw the line. Why wouldn't Washington State be able to sue federal regulations and change wage rules for seasonal workers, saying, you know, you're going to impede the ability of our businesses to get apple pickers. I just find that a broad decision on the standing question in this case is really going to open some very wide and important doors on
thank you. I wanted to, there's kind of a school of thought. I wanted to ask about the APA standing issue, too, and whether you all have thoughts on that. Because there's kind of a school of thought that with Justice Scalia's death, that actually this case may be decided quite narrowly. I mean, it might be decided on a notice and comment issue, for example, and not get into the kind of broad take care issues or the arbitrary, the separation of powers issues. And so did you all want to speak on kind of the APA standing issues? Are those a separate set of issues, or should we? Karen, anything on that?
I don't want to add more than what I said already, I think, in terms of what they are. I'm interested in hearing more discussion about the arbitrary and capricious part.
I think that's so let's jump to that then. And it's the closest to kind of the policy. We're not supposed to be taking up policy issues, but this is one where it's almost going to be inevitable that kind of there be some kind of a policy discussion here, because I think that the question is the president acting well beyond his authority, essentially legislating against Congress's will with these programs, or are these programs simply an expression of prosecutorial discretion, and a very sensible, expression of prosecutorial discretion that creates no new legal status? And the argument on that side is that it's deferred action. Basically, it's not legal status. It's simply a label that signifies that the government's exercising prosecutorial discretion. And we'd have to say that a number of people within these two potential program beneficiary groups are fairly kind of vested in the country and have families and have the traditional kind of equitable ties that would give rise to prosecutorial discretion. So anyway, is this arbitrary and capricious or not?
Can I just make one marker point?
Yes.
Get out of the way of the fans here. On this point, I think it's important to highlight something that Karen helped us see in her introduction. When the district court made its decision, it was on APA grounds, and it basically was, you have to go through the regular notice and comment rulemaking process if you're going to put a program in place like this. There was commentary, but basically purely commentary on the substance, but basically purely a procedural decision. At the Fifth Circuit, they agreed that the APA barred this barred implementation of this program, but they added something very important in addition to the notice and comment rulemaking piece. They also concluded that this action was arbitrary and capricious and manifestly contrary to the statute. And that goes a lot, those are big words, and that goes a lot farther than just finding that there should have been a proposed rule with an opportunity for public comment. That really does underscore that squarely involved in this case is the legality of what the president did. Now,
And I guess kind of to that, do you think on the notice and comment portion, do you think that is, if they were to find yes, you had to have notice and comment, does that do anything but delay things? Like where is the substance on that piece? That's what I was kind of struggling with, because if there's a notice and comment, the states can say or others can say, all interest groups, many more than filed these briefs, would all spend money to file papers and kind of advocating various things, but at the end of the day, the federal government on notice and comment could still go forward with this rulemaking. So what difference does that piece make? Or is it just kind of a stall tactic to get to the next round?
I mean, to me, as a matter of law, I think you're exactly right. That just opens up the government to go back through the notice and comment process if the court finds that was the key reason why this is unlawful. I don't think that would be just delay. That's going to have a lot to depend on. That's going to depend a lot on what happens in November and who's the next president, what that president chooses to do, and how that president chooses to see his or her authority. But I do believe, obviously, of course, if the court decides that was the basis why this is wrong, then it does leave the executive, should it choose to, whoever it is, open just to start that point. And there's probably some strategy. You can probably do some Monday morning quarterbacking about strategy, whether there should have
this is the administration.
Well, and if they did do that, if they did decide it on such a narrow ground, it would, A, leave it open to the next executive, whoever kind of he or she is, but then it would also get the court out of what I think, Don, you've really identified is quite the pickle in terms of opening up additional standing or having take care challenges, you know, kind of all the time. And so if it could go and decide this on something narrowly, push the ball kind of down the court, I think in terms of its effect on broader jurisprudence, it could be much less.
Right. The thing that I'm thinking about sort of in the background, I look at the questions presented in order and I start analyzing them in order, but I don't think that they can be resolved in the order that they're stated, right? It seems to me first you have to resolve standing, and then there's the question of standing for Texas at least versus everybody else. And do you need to resolve everybody else? I mean, maybe the court could even ignore everybody else as long as they uphold the finding that at least Texas has standing, but I'll leave that in abeyance for a minute. But then next, that you have the rulemaking question, but I don't see how you avoid the rulemaking question, because if it's required, it's required. I don't think you can say, well, it was technically required, but let's assume they did it, right? I don't think that works. It may be a big delay factor. It may be a practical problem in the way that it was done. But if it's required, I think it's required, and I think it has to go back for rulemaking if that's what's held. And then the analysis, I think, has to be, if it's not required, then we can look at whether it's arbitrary and capricious and whether the take care clause comes in. But I don't see a way that you can say notice and comment rulemaking was technically required, but it doesn't matter and we're just going to reach the merits. I'm interested in what others think.
I certainly agree with that. I certainly agree with that. I mean, I think that, you know, just to visit for a moment what the APA question is, and this is oversimplified, but the APA question, the notice and comment question, is basically, was this a legislative or substantive rule that required notice and comment rulemaking, or was it a general statement of policy? And that's where the parties disagree. And that disagreement has centered on at least partly on whether or not these decisions are discretionary. And the states challenging the action have made a very significant point of saying it's not really discretionary. You know, the president has said, you know, has compared this to the military. When an order is issued, people are expected to obey. There will be consequences if you don't. They can point to, you know, they can't point to cases where DACA applications were denied as a matter of discretion, as opposed to one of the articulated disabilities from getting DACA relief. To me, that a little bit misses the fundamental point about executive decision making. That's pretty important to, you know, across the board, but especially in immigration law, at least in my experience in immigration law, which is that I don't think a decision becomes any less discretionary because it's made at a high level. And then of someone who's got the authority to make that decision and expecting people who are under his or her charge to carry it out. I mean, just to simplify it and think of an analogous situation, you know, if Julie's a police chief and at the morning muster tells us all, there's a heroin epidemic, I don't want you to spend time today on public drunkenness. Spend your time on trying to attack the heroin issue. If I go out and arrest people in the alleys of my neighborhood for being drunk, then I can see her feeling like I hadn't carried out her instruction. But I don't think that changes the nature of her basic decision as a discretionary one, and as a policy choice. And so that's my own particular view. But I think that's a key part of what's going to determine the court's. That's a key question that's going to determine the court's decision about whether or not APA.
And I think that, Bo, I think that's, you know, incredibly interesting thinking about where does the discretion sit and at what level does the discretion sit. And one of the things that I found most interesting in the district court opinion, the Fifth Circuit opinion, is that the district court made specific factual findings on this discretion and said although the DAPA memo purports to say there's discretion, nothing about DAPA generally leaves the agency's employees free to exercise their discretion. In fact, discretion is a pretext. and so made a number of factual findings, including citing to the affidavit of a law enforcement union, talking about the number of pages of instructions. And why does this matter? Why does it matter that the district court made findings around, factual findings around the discretion piece? It matters because the standard of review here, for findings of fact, the standard of review is clearly erroneous. And so the standard of review is not like on the conclusion of law side, on whether or not they're standing, that's subject to broad review. In other words, the Supreme Court can go back and look legally and reinterpret, no, I think Massachusetts versus EPA means this or that. But on the facts, the Supreme Court and the Fifth Circuit could only look at, was the district court's finding of fact clearly erroneous? Here, I think this was very broad fact finding. This was, it kind of surprised me how broadly they did that, but I think this could be, the standard review piece on these factual findings could be significant. The other point I would make on the discretion is that it's different to say we have priorities versus we're gonna trigger eligibility for benefits. And the trigger of the eligibility for benefits, that's the piece that I think is different than what we've seen in the past, particularly where, and I would put the big asterisk there, where Congress has said not just no, but you know, heck no, at least 15 times, right, over a period of years and years and years. And so Congress has said, absolutely not. We provided specific categories in the INA, including dealing with parents of adult, you know, adult parents of children. We've made specific rulings on this. Congress has said no, and yet, you know, the administration came in and said, we're not just going to give you lawful, we're not just going to say we're not going to take prosecutorial action against you. We are going to confer you lawful presence, which triggers the eligibility for benefits. And so that's the piece that I think is different. And that's, and I think in thinking about whether or not it's arbitrary and capricious, this benefits piece is very important. Some of the briefs make reference to things that have been done in other times after 9/11 or other times where there has been deferred action plus benefits. I think that one important distinction in those cases, and it'll be interesting to see if the Supreme Court thinks this, is that in those cases, Congress wanted it. It was kind of a bridge to where Congress wanted to go, as opposed to kind of a hand in Congress's face that we're gonna act. And I think, so that's where I think there's a difficult piece, but I have to say, I was very surprised at how broad the district court was with the factual findings, and then thinking about the standard review, it made me think, gee, will that be an issue? Because I agree with you. I think discretion can come from much higher than the agency employees. You're not going to allow the GSA to make all the decisions, right? You're going to give them guidance on how they use their discretion, and that guidance can come from very high up.
Can I make a couple, I think one's a clarifying question, and the other, yeah, well, actually, there's two questions here. The first is about discretion. I mean, we're talking about two kinds of discretion. First of all, did he have the discretion to create a program like this? Is this a proper exercise of prosecutorial discretion? But there's also that issue that I think was raised in the district court, which is, do the people actually entertaining these applications have any discretion to deny them? And so I wanted to ask that question and have you talk about that a little bit. And then the second thing is, Obama himself has kind of, I feel like, done himself no favors in terms of what he said, like the creation of the DACA program, which is that I can't go farther than this. If I go farther than this, I'm making laws myself, and it's Congress's role. And he's also, on the discretion issue, he also kind of, at some point, compared this order to almost like a military type of order. You know, I mean, in his language may have been kind of sloppy, and he may have retracted that, but I wonder if you all could respond to what, you know, what both of those issues, and also kind of as the, what weight would the court give to the president's own statements on these programs and his expression of his own authority to make these kind of broad programs administratively?
Well, I agree with the characterization that it's unfortunate or a problematic statement for him or something like that, but I really don't think it has any legal effect or that the court will decide it. Someone may cite to it, someone may mention it, but I don't think the decision will turn on how he characterized the original DACA announcement. On your point about discretion, I agree that the issue of discretion at the lower level adjudicator point about whether to actually approve or deny a particular application is kind of a red herring, and that's not the real discretion that we're talking about. The real discretion is the discretion to create the program, and I think pointing at that is a diversion from what the real big issues are. But there are legitimate issues about what Julie was talking about, I think, whether there is discretion to go that far, to attach benefits to enforcement priorities and so forth. The thing that I think is most significant in trying to sort that one out is that when you look at what Congress did and what Congress decided about or didn't decide about eligibility for permanent residence or even for cancellation of removal in the case of parents, it was a different context, and it is apples and oranges in a sense, because that was talking about a permanent remedy, a permanent form of relief, and this is, by definition, time-limited and not an ongoing path to whatever the next stage of relief is. So I don't think you can say, if he did an executive order and said, I'm letting everybody stay forever and line up to get your green card, I think that argument would be stronger than what we have now, which is a, you know, 3-year at most temporary permission to be present as opposed to status.
But I mean, I agree with you, Karen. I think one challenge is, though, on the to that point, that it's temporary, is that in the immigration context, we have been terrible with things that are temporary. And so we give temporary status to people for world disasters that happened, you know, multiple decades ago. And so temporary doesn't really mean temporary. And I think no one means temporary to mean temporary either. I don't think the president's I don't think the goal of this is to have 3 years and then you know everybody will not have authorization anymore. And so I certainly agree with you that it's not supposed to be ongoing, I think in reality it seems like it could be ongoing. And I do agree, Don, that the president's his own comments have been very unfortunate, including one where he said the failure of Congress to enact reform that prompted him to change the law. And that's a pretty direct, you know, statement that he's changing the law. It's not that he is creating discretion or acting with discretion. He is changing the law. And again, I feel very much that the president may have had no choice because Congress has failed to act when we all know that immigration reform is you know, badly needed. This is a completely messed up system. But I think what he did, from my view, is extraordinary. And I know in the Bush administration, we were looking very much, trying to get Congress to pass immigration reform, couldn't get them to do it, trying to look at what can we do administratively and how much can we do. And I think there was a view that we couldn't go any further than we did, which was not that far, and that you couldn't do something that would give people benefits and do something that forward thinking. So I would be very interested in Bo's perspective on whether that's something that is kind of within the scope of what the IMA kind of would allow or expect.
Yeah, I mean, look, you know, you look at the president's comments, and they certainly have featured, there's a lot of them, and they feature pretty heavily in the comments of those who oppose this on policy grounds. They appear very heavily in congressional hearings. They appear very heavily on you know, Fox News commentary. They appear very heavily in the legal challenges. I'm glad I'm not the one who wrote any of those talking points.
I'll second that.
My kids show me vines sometimes, and often they're little microbursts of video clips that are strung together in pretty effective ways. And this one is just, you know, this you could do just an awful one. You know, I can't wave a magic wand. DACA is as far as I can go. I just changed the law, et cetera, et cetera. It goes on. I think there's a few things that you can draw from that. One is, I certainly agree that, you know, presidential statements at press conferences are not good sources of understanding the legal reasoning of an administration. Number two, I think it is true that at the time that DACA was announced, it did represent, as far as the administration comfortably thought it, maybe not even comfortably thought it could go at that time. And, you know, my betting money says that not long before DACA, the administration didn't think it'd go that far.
Right. Memos show that, right? Internal memos.
I think the main takeaway from this is that this is complicated. This is not a map that has those bright red lines that we all crave to tell us where the authority begins and where it ends. And so you have to approach it in a different way to try to get to the right answer. And it is complex. And you know, I think the Supreme Court is going to have to filter out a lot of noise to get to the core of this and to get to the right answer. And from my perspective, the way to break it down is into two basic questions, and then what are the basic principles on those two questions. Question number one, did the president and does the secretary of DHS and does the executive agency have the authority to defer action on this scale? And question number two is, if they do they have the authority to authorize employment for those people who are approved for deferred action? And on number one, I do think it is an oversimplification to say, deferred action programs like this are just how administrations roll. It's been going on forever. Because I think it's important to acknowledge, at least to me, that on a raw number scale, this is bigger than what's been done in the past. And that may have legal consequences, it may not. We can explore whether there's an articulable limit, numeric limit. But I do think it is the case that in principle, it is the same kind of thing that presidents of both parties have done for a very long time. And I think that, to me, one of the key places, I am on amicus brief, I do think that this is lawful, although complicated. I do think this is lawful, so let me just put my views out there right now. I do disagree with the states here. I think on this point, the fundamental place where they go wrong is to regard this question of legality as a binary one, as a black and white one, as an up or down one, where you're either here legally or you're here legally. And that is a very appealing construct, and most people think of immigration law in those terms. I would have thought that I did when I first came to the subject. But that's not the case. And it hasn't been for a very long time, if it's ever been. There is up top, there is such a thing as status. There's lawful immigration status as a permanent resident, as a non-immigrant, or in a certain small number of classifications that Congress has created, asylum, refugees, etc. Status, only Congress can put you into lawful immigration status. But below that, there's countless gray shaded immigration conditions that are less than lawful immigration status, but that don't necessarily equate to just straight up being here unlawfully, or that plus something else. And those things are basically the room where the administration has done all kinds of different things. There is parole, although that's now recognized by statute. But there is deferred action. There are periods of stay authorized by the Attorney General. There's unlawful presence. There are people who are here illegally but not running unlawful presence. You can go through and list forever the kinds of immigration conditions that are less than legal immigration status, but something different from or more than simply being here illegally. And I think that's a fundamental flaw in how the states bring this challenge. You can see throughout the brief, you can't just with the wave of a wand declare something legal to be legal. You can't go wholesale against what Congress has said. You can't ignore the laws. And I think that binary view and failing to recognize that there's a lot of stuff that you can do administratively and have for generations is where the states go wrong. And the policy panel's coming up, but to me the importance of that is that just like immigration law is complex, immigration reality is complex, and things happen every day that require very difficult judgments to be made about agencies administering the immigration system. There are going to be hurricanes that keep people who have been admitted as students from fulfilling the terms of their non-immigrant visas. And you know, once you do that, you're here legally. There are going to be earthquakes that interrupt the orphan adoption process from countries where that's an important part of the relationship between the two countries. There are going to be situations where you want to move your border enforcement resources from one area to another, or focus on different kinds of crimes in prioritizing your criminal your immigration enforcement against those who have committed crimes. There are going to be situations where you have millions more people here than we have the ability or the will nationally to remove, or the money to remove, and you've got to make choices about what to do with them. That's the daily life of someone running the immigration system.
Yeah.
And it seems to me you want to really keep,
yeah.
I think people of both parties would want to really keep a broad view of administrative flexibility.
Well, I think maybe an important point is that, you know, a lot of people are in favor of broad expressions of executive action depending on kind of what administration they're supporting at the time. You know, if Ted Cruz is president, the type of administrative action that we might expect would be very, very different, you know. And I think that's something to keep in mind. But it occurs to me that I thought that the discussion would basically be a fairly narrow discussion on standing. And as I look at this and listen to you, and particularly Bo's words there have galvanized this for me, you can't avoid in at least three of these issues really getting into, in a very significant way, issues of executive authority, issues of separation of powers, and all of these kind of enormous issues, like, is the guidance arbitrary, capricious, or otherwise not in accordance with the law? That gets you directly into the issue of whether the president's acting beyond his authority, essentially legislating against Congress's will, or is doing what other presidents have done and will need to do in the future in terms of programs like Deferred Action, DED, parole, all of these types of discretionary programs. The same thing on the APA's notice and comment procedures. You know, I mean, you get into very deep issues when you're talking about, is this a substantive rule or a general statement of policy? And of course, the addition of the take care clause, you know, is very broad in and of itself. Is the president faithfully executing the laws? So it's really hard to, now that I think of it, it's harder than I thought it would be to imagine a decision that isn't a large decision here. I mean, do you all agree with that? I'm curious. I guess the question is, how might the court decide this?
I'm not going to go there yet, but it's obviously a big decision with huge impact and is going to affect a lot of people. What the thing that I'm curious, and it has big legal implications too, I should say, for other than immigration, for future administrations, as you point out, Don. So it's really big, and I think it'll be interesting to see how much of it actually turns on the underlying immigration issues and how they how or whether they try to duck any of the issues. And one thing I didn't say in the overview, but I should have, is this appeal is about the preliminary injunction and the affirmance of the preliminary injunction. So the case could end at the Supreme Court if the injunction is upheld, but if it's dissolved, there's still the matter of the trial on the merits, right? The injunction goes away, but the actual challenges are still there. So the potential to go back to Texas to the district court and fight about some of these issues lives another day. So this is not, while we're talking about how big it is, necessarily the end of the whole case. And I know Julie wants to say something, but I realized when we were talking, Don, one thing we didn't talk about at all in the arbitrary and capricious part, and committed to agency discretion, we talked about Congress not acting and the president's need, in a sense, to move forward and do something to deal with this population. We didn't talk about the worker protection, the public safety implications, all of those things that balance, in a sense, not only the immigration fight, but the reason of getting people
you know, as the language is, out of the shadows onto the rolls, paying taxes. There are non-squarely immigration reasons that support the action, and I don't know if people want to address those at all, but I just realized that we didn't touch them until then.
And certainly I would agree that there are that there are public safety and other reasons why something like this would make sense. I think query whether those reasons can trump Congress's, you know, refusal, not just not acting, but kind of saying no when these things were brought to them multiple times. I want to comment on one thing Mo said and then turn to the portion I'm most worried about. I certainly agree that prosecutorial discretion has been done kind of over time. Many of those things are later validated by Congress, like temporary protected status, and you know, when it expires, everybody's racing to Congress to get it extended and things like that. I think what is unusual here and is really extraordinary is the wholesale reclassification of folks into, and then allowing them then to be eligible for benefits. And that is what is so different, and that is what is unique, and that is what's different than DED or all the other sorts of discretion. And also, usually when we think of discretion, particularly where Congress is involved, we're thinking of that on individualized case-by-case basis. And that's why you see that in the memos, and that's where some of the discretion discussion came up with, individualized case-by-case basis versus moving whole categories and giving benefits, which can be very significant, to whole categories of individuals. But I want to talk for just a minute about the Take Care Clause, because in my view, I very much hope that the Supreme Court does not reach the Take Care Clause, and regardless of whether the president has overstepped his bounds here. I think allowing challenges on the Take Care Clause is very scary and sets us up for a whole lot of litigation on the Take Care Clause. And perhaps just raising it as a question has already done that, unless the Supreme Court shuts it down. But you don't want, presidents of all types are more and more dependent on executive actions kind of all across the board in areas far beyond the immigration. And what you don't want is for every single one of them to be looked at and challenged under the Take Care Clause. And I think if the Supreme Court validates that Take Care Clause is an issue or isn't an issue, maybe says doesn't apply here but it could somewhere else, I think you're going to see a huge kind of rash of litigation that's going to be added as the final question on every Supreme Court brief, and I think that's really kind of bad for the country, because I think given the way Congress refuses to act on a lot of things, given the deadlock that we're in, you have to have executive action. And so if the president is going to face these kind of day in, day out challenges on the Take Care Clause, to me, I'm really troubled. I'm really troubled by that, and I don't think it bodes well, as someone who served in the executive branch for a long time, to have the executive branch, act. And so I hope they avoid that. Maybe that was Justice Scalia's special interest or someone else. Maybe they won't get there. I think they can decide this without getting there, and I hope they won't, I'll say. I don't know if you guys have views on that piece.
Well, I hope they avoid it also, and one thing I've been struggling with is why they even put it in there and asked for briefing on it. I read one commentary that said, and so now I wasn't smart enough to think of it, but I'm hopefully embracing this as the reason, that perhaps it was because it was an issue lingering in the case somewhere, and they wanted to dispose of it, even though it wasn't presented by the parties squarely in the cert petition. So asking to have it brought before them so they can dispense with it may be what's going on. I'll be interested to see if that's what happens.
Yeah, I mean, the addition, the late addition of this question, it certainly fits thematically with a lot of the opposition that was being expressed to the program. It's a wholesale departure, it's a wholesale failure to enforce the laws, et cetera. I agree very much with Julie that it would be unfortunate for there to be a Supreme Court decision that opens the door to wide challenges to huge swaths of areas of executive activity under the Take Care Clause. And I also agree, I think Karen hit this on the head earlier in the discussion, I think that the resolution of the Take Care, if they get to the Take Care issue, a lot of it is going to depend on the basic issue about whether it's lawful in the first place, which I think takes us right back to at least what I see as the two questions that are there. Did the president have this authority by nature to defer action to this group? And if he did he have the authority to authorize their employment? And that, to me, is the pair of core legal questions.
It occurs to me, listening to you, you've been in government posts before, how difficult it would be if, say, you were on a transition team to advise kind of an incoming administration on the scope of prosecutorial authority at this point, prosecutorial discretion. I mean, what? Maybe another way to ask this is, what kind of advice would you try to provide in terms of what an incoming president could actually do in terms of extending, not, I know it's complicated to say legal status because we're not really talking about legal status, but a reprieve from removal, for example, to particular groups. How far could the president go? We've been in that position before, both of you.
All right, I'll go first. I would tell the incoming president that this is bigger than what's been done before, but that there's authority for it. I mean, there's no question that deferred action has existed as a part of the administrative toolbox for a very long time. It's been used by administrations of both parties. It has been used on large scales, not numerically this scale, but it has been used on large scales, and it's been regarded as an important part of the administrative toolbox. One of the arguments against this exercise of deferred action is that it goes beyond what Congress has authorized, and so the states point to the very particular areas where Congress has talked about deferred action. Congress in those areas didn't talk about deferred action because it was trying to create a deferred action authority. It was talking about deferred action authority because deferred action was already out there as an administrative mechanism that was in place, and it was saying how it wanted deferred action to be exercised in certain instances, or what it wanted the consequences of deferred action to be in certain instances. For example, it said, if you've given someone deferred action, executive branch, I will recognize that. Congress will recognize that as a someone who can get a federally compliant driver's license. That doesn't mean that purport to affect the number of people who can be given deferred action. It just recognizes that deferred action is out there. I don't see where the numeric line, this is bigger, but I don't see any articulation of where the numeric line exists.
And Bo, I just want to interject one question on your prior analysis about the two big questions, and the second one being the availability, the ability to give benefits, work permit in particular. Isn't the closest deferred action parallel there is the original DACA, which came with that and has been, you know, in a legal sense, inconsequential?
Not in terms of the size of the
group? No, not in terms of the size, the legal structure.
Oh.
Deferred action plus a work permit for not an insignificant number of people.
I agree with that. That, to me, raises, though, a complicated question. That you know, the parties in Texas is saying, we're not challenging DACA.
But
if it's correct that DAPA is manifestly contrary to the statute, then why isn't DACA? I mean, I think that issue is put out there. So I think that does focus on the work authorization issue. I think it does make sense for us to spend just a couple minutes focusing on that.
I do want to get to questions maybe in a couple minutes here. Go ahead, please. Go.
Just to highlight the legal arguments against the ability to leave. Or let me distill it down even further. The fact that the executive has authority beyond what Congress has specifically authorized to allow someone to be employed in this country, that's been in place for half a century. It's been recognized in regulations since the 1970s. It's been recognized by statute since the 1970s in a farm labor context that was later expanded with IRCA. It was recognized in 1996, reconfirmed. I mean, it has been the case for ages that Congress, that the agency has in practice and by regulation, and that Congress has recognized and ratified that someone can be authorized to be employed through action of the immigration.
I think in terms of size, the biggest example would be the family unity case as opposed to Irving. Is that right? And I'm not sure whether, now that I think of it, I'm not sure whether they were given work authorization.
Yeah, they were.
Oh, they were. Okay.
They were. There was a spat about size. There were estimates that were quite large. About 1.5 million, I think estimated 4 million undocumented at the time. It was one estimate that the agency gave of the number of people who could be authorized for employment. The actual number of people, I think, was smaller. But I think that point is very, I think that helps us answer the question. That was a time when Congress provided for legal status for a big number of the undocumented, didn't provide for the same kind of legalization for their spouses and children. The agency did defer action on their removal and did authorize their employment.
Right.
And that was later ratified by Congress.
It's a little different, though.
Yeah.
It's a little different.
It's a little different
yeah.
In terms of the ratification and kind of where Congress was coming from. Just to get back on your previous question, just for a second before
right.
questions, I think if I were to advise someone kind of coming in and looking at that, they're going to have a whole host of executive orders on immigration, right? And basically, in this case of health, I'm going to say you can do anything, right? Anything is doable, essentially, within the INA, and that may not be bad in terms of to get to where we are. But the key thing that I would advise them to do is try to get up with Congress and try to meet with them and try to get support, because they're going to need the funding support. They're going to need, we can't keep doing kind of this piecemeal. So try to get some consensus or buy-in from Congress. If you don't have that, it's going to be very difficult. When the 3 years are up, they're going to fight it. When you're just going to have kind of roadblock after roadblock. So I think trying to get some sort of buy-in and the funding that you may need for some piece of this would be my first recommendation for them.
I think everybody's going to agree with getting past the roadblocks if that's at all possible.
But to prioritize it, not
right.
to make it, not immigration
right.
can't be a second term issue again.
Sure.
You got to go to the front. And I think thinking about the cost of this, if all these things are still in place, tremendous costs and collateral costs to all these agencies,
sure.
and try to get Congress agreement on those.
Total agreement. So let's go to questions. You all have listened to this great discussion. Do you have particular questions for our legal experts?
My name is D.C. Drake. I'm an immigration attorney in Old Town Alexandria. I had to write this down because it gets complicated. The more you think about it, the more stuff you write down. But I have two sort of broad things to ask about and say. One is, as to standing, you're sort of dividing the line between the a state legislative program that is pre-existing versus post-existing, I think is a good point. I also thought about, does it matter whether it's an easy program to amend or fix in light of a new federal policy? Does it matter the size of the injury? In other words, if, for example, if it's $75 a pop for these subsidies for driver's licenses, whereas if you have a state program that allows in-state tuition for everyone with a work permit, that's a larger injury. Does that matter vis-a-vis the upsetting of the federal apple cart if this injury allows your state to shut down a federal program? Is that relevant to standing at all?
I think certainly the size of the injury, it is something that the court looks at, but the Fifth Circuit said, citing the Supreme Court, it's not an accounting exercise. And so one of the things that the government, U.S. government, tried to do in this case is say, actually, although Texas was going to subsidize these licenses to the tune of, I guess, $24 a license, actually, there'll be other benefits that will accrue to Texas with all these new individuals with lawful status. And what the Fifth Circuit said, looking at the Supreme Court precedent on this, is that actually you can't weigh the cost and benefits from different places. It has to be kind of a germane, something that directly relates kind of to the licenses in this instance. So I think the accounting exercise piece is going to be an important one. Do they want to look at the broader issues? Obviously, if all these people have legal status, there's going to be a lot of benefits to the states, and those aren't calculated. And is it appropriate? I think that's a good question. Is it appropriate to take it in there? with respect to how easy it is for a state to change the law, I think there, they also referred to some Supreme Court opinions that said it didn't matter if it'd be that easy for them to change the law. Whether or not those opinions are just or right, is something different, but I think the Supreme Court in other circumstances has said that, you know, that doesn't matter that much, but the pre-existing piece did. If they had changed it after, you know, these were in effect, I think it would be a different equation. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm not sure, maybe they knew this was coming down the pike. You know, I'm not involved enough in Texas legislative action to know if that was the case.
Yeah, what I would tend to think, because there is that prong about forcing them to change the law or be under substantial pressure, and the substantial pressure is, there's some language in the cases about, thinking about having to change it. So you could infer from that what it would cost or how easy or hard it would be to ultimately do it wouldn't matter, because the issue is it forces them to confront a problem with their current law. But I guess if you get past that and drill down, or if you sort of hold that concept in your head and then look how expensive, how hard or easy, I imagine it would play in, but I don't think it gets you over it altogether just if it's negligible.
I feel like I should just say briefly about Walter Dellinger's brief. It's on this issue, and it'd be worth for people to read it. I think what his argument is over an extended brief is that there's no causation here, in the sense that you have to have an injury in fact, and it has to be caused by the executive's action, and it's not caused because the state could easily avoid that injury by raising those fees and not subsidizing them. And again, of course, the state disagrees with that very vociferously.
Can I pick up on one thing Julie said, just to follow up on that? I've just lost my... Is there any... You're talking about accounting and numbers. I imagine that giving work permits to a lot of people who didn't have them before and so on would increase economic activity. Any consideration given to that?
And that's exactly the piece that at least the Fifth Circuit kind of rejected. It's like the side... the side benefits can't come in to offset this $24 subsidy. But I think that's a fair point, and I haven't studied the Supreme Court opinions in enough detail to know if the Fifth Circuit's determination on the accounting exercise and cost and benefits was accurate in terms of what they did, but I think they certainly shut down that argument. But I think it's a very fair point to look at the overall economic impacts, that positive impacts that this group will have on the country.
Thanks. I mean, the other thing is, as I recall, there's this issue of kind of the additional costs to the states in terms of education, healthcare, et cetera, for people who would be more likely to stay, but there's no finding on that, whether the fact, and I suppose it's intuitive, but that if you're given some kind of deferral of removal, that you would be more likely to stay, and there would be increased costs, because those costs, some of those costs the state's going to bear anyway, right?
But in this case, the court wasn't even willing to take into fact that people who had driver's licenses would be more likely to get insurance, for example,
right,
which seems kind of very related. And so,
which also seems like a good to the state, but that's another question, right?
Well, these arguments, and people, they're not really about the $24
right,
for the driver's license,
right?
Right? It's kind of the broader principle.
Right. Okay, other questions?
Kevin Appleby with CMS. I was going to ask you sort of Don's question about what the court would decide, your opinion, if you were up there on the court, had the black robe on, how you would vote and why. But I won't ask that, unless you want to answer that. But I'm going to ask a different take on that, and that is, if you were on the court on Monday and listening to the oral arguments, what questions would you ask of either the states or the administration that would help clarify your thinking on where the decision should go? I mean, are there some outstanding issues that you can't gather from the lower courts, from the briefs, that need to be answered in order for the justices to come to the right conclusion? And if you were there, what would those questions be?
I like Bo's question about, you know, where's the limits on the standing question? If it's here, then where isn't it? That's not a factual question.
in the way that in the Arizona argument, it was, you know, how long does a roadside stop take, right? Is it 7 minutes? Is it whatever? It's not that kind of a question, but it's one that, to me, could be pivotal in the way we address it.
I think one question that Karen raised earlier was very interesting. It's how much injury to one state, you know, how does that bubble over to affect kind of the whole country for the nationwide injunction? And I think that's kind of an interesting, would be something that would be interesting to explore and to have them look at a little bit.
I think I would wonder, the states specifically are not challenging the enforcement priorities, the new enforcement priorities. So if the problem is that, or that deferred action exists on some scale, if the problem is that this is just too big, how do I understand where the line is? And secondly, I would say, if the problem is that employment authorization converted this into a program and therefore made it impermissible, how do I look at the statute and understand whether I, the president, could or couldn't authorize employment in this situation?
Additional questions? Yes.
Thank you. I'm Alejandro Solori with the Embassy of Mexico, and I apologize for my complete ignorance in jurisprudence and the system. But is there precedent in jurisprudence, or there's a chance that the Supreme Court decides something for one of the states, one of the plaintiffs, and something for the others? Or there's a standing for 5 out of the 26, and we see an injunction in Texas and in other of the states in the future? Or the decision would be, would address nationally, would be a national decision, or only for Texas or the other states that would have standing?
Well, my sense is that if they find jurisdiction for, uphold jurisdiction for at least one of the states, specifically Texas, that they'll go on and deal with the whole case. I don't even think they necessarily have to make a ruling on standing as to the others, but what's in front of them right now is a national preliminary injunction, so they have to deal with that. So I think if they're standing, they're going to have to address it, and it's, I would say, technically possible but unlikely as a practical matter that they would start upholding the injunction as to one state and dispensing with it as to others, because it is, after all, a national program with enforcement and benefits in immigration committed to the federal government. So I find it, I mean, because you could defeat it by just having people move around. I don't think you'll have a thing where it's, the injunction is upheld in Texas, but everywhere else the program can go forward. That doesn't seem legally or practically likely to me.
Let me just ask if the panelists would like to say any final comments, because I think we should maybe take 5 minutes after this session before the next one. Any further questions?
I guess, Don, going back to Kevin's point about one question to ask is on the rulemaking thing, what's the strongest argument that notice and comment rulemaking was not required? That's probably something I would.
You'd ask the administration arguing it in the case. Yes. Okay. Okay. Well, look, I wanted to thank you all. I thought that was a great discussion. I learned a lot, and we appreciate your taking the time. It'll be interesting to see what happens on Monday and beyond.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.